Freelancer, and they've always all been associated directly or indirectly with ECAD or some of the classes that he has taken. He still continues to teach out of his interest in many positions. So I think he's really a living, shining example of gaining knowledge is one thing, but sharing it is really, really critical. And I think that's where Freelancer is a true example of, and really a motivation for everybody from 20 to 60-year-olds. Thank you, Freelancer. You keep us going, and we can't express it in words, but I think we continue to look.
Absolutely. So thanks, Arun. The enthusiasm, he just now he's sharing a picture right from his cell phone that he spent time in BEL, right, teaching about signal integrity aspect, right? That speaks, right? Which I got to know now. So thanks a lot for your time again. So there's another picture. Actually, this chapter. After the EDAPs in 2014, again we wanted to really be active a little bit. So Arun and Dipanjan were really active, they were leading the efforts 2014. So from that point again we wanted to revive. So again, Mr. SLN is part of the core committee, he's the vice chair of the Okay, that's thanks from Dipanjan. Why don't you just come over to the
I think I sense that if you could please come on the stage and we'd like to present you with some token of our appreciation. May I please invite the chairman of Department of ECE to present the shawl to us. Suresh, perhaps from the society, if you could present him.
I certainly have to, because I'm trying to replicate your warmth by these shots, but your warmth has been much more than any of those things. I'm able to go through all these things because, first of all, when I landed in this department way back in 1966 with Professor Iyer as the chairperson of this department, the first thing he told me was, if you don't know what you are doing today, you are not going to be in tomorrow. And that's something with that age which I kept continuously thinking. And I was very fortunate to be working with great people, Professor Dhawan, when I started my career here as a faculty member. And then after going to BEL, we had a lot of high professionally attitude liking people like Captain Prabhala, Colonel G.K. Rao. And it was always an innovation, thought process, and thinking all the time. And the one thing I learned when I stepped into ECE department was, leave your books aside, start thinking loud, be analytical, analyze a problem, solve a problem, rather than worrying about a problem. And I always feel that sharing whatever I have learned through the ages, either by mistakes or by learning through others, is always a great methodology by which you can share how not to do things and how to do things in the right perspective. And my entrepreneur career, I owe it to Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, because when he used to go from BEL with projects and worked with him for about 3 years for many projects, we always used to be behind schedule, in those days. Time was not a criteria because anything can happen. So he used to say, if this meeting is to say we are delayed by 6 weeks, I think you can have your 2 Mary biscuits and tea and then carry on. There's no point in discussing. And he only said, it is time that you start your own company so that there are no delays. It's not that Mir was doing delays, it was because it's a large organization, we have too many projects to conquer, and we had less resources in those days. Today, resources are in plenty, we can get anything done. So I thank him for being my mentor. And my energy comes from all these youngsters. Because, you know, just like the solar cell absorbs the radiation from the sun, I get their energy and pop up my battery cells and make sure that I am able to continue to teach or continue to propagate what I've been thinking. Thank you very much for this kind honor. And thank you, Dipanjan, Arun, Suresh, Anil, was one of my favorite boys, blue-eyed boys. And I have Ramakrishna was my senior in ECE here and also in BEA. Right? Thank you very much.
So moving to the we have a technical presentation today, which I'll share with my colleague Bibhu Prasad Nayak. But before I start, you know, I also want to say one thing about Excellencer. You know a person by the people around him, right? Which is what is called a multiplier, right? It's not as important how good you are. People around you or people who you inspire, if they're as good as you or better than you, then you are successful, right? So that goes very well with Excellencer. I've done that for it. So thank you. All right. So, in alignment with electronic packaging, right? So today I want to talk about electronic design automation for automotive electronics packaging, right? And before I start, a quick recap, right? So, what are the electronic issues that we deal with systems in general, right? So a quick recap of system level trend. And this we have seen from 2009, end of 1990s, 2000, that along with the scaling in the chip, right, a lot of value was coming through the systems where integrated solutions could actually give you more functionality, higher frequencies, etc. Right? So typically the words at that point of time were system in packet and system on chip. System on chip is still a very hot topic today. Most people are going this route, some people are going this route, right? So what are the main challenges in them? Well, there was signal integrity challenges, right? So what I'm going to try to do is for people who are interested in this topic, right, and want to pursue that in future, I'll show you one of the avenues where this or similar expertise has a lot of opportunities, right? So first, let's talk about signal integrity in the package. This is a slide that I've shown several times. So this is a section of a package, and this is the part where the chip sits, and this is the part where it goes out, fans into the board, and goes to another chip, right? Let's assume that this is a ASIC chip sitting here, and it wants to talk to memory, right? What are the problems there, right? What is it that can go wrong? Well, one thing is you may assume that this is a wire, right? This is a wire, so this connection is the same as that connection. 1 volt here, same as 1 volt there. Does not happen, right? Does not happen at that high frequencies. There are several effects like loss, radiation, insertion loss, all that, right? And your job is to send a signal like 1, 0s from the chip side and detect it as the same 1s and 0s on the other side. Right. Even if there's some loss, we know from communication theory, etc., how to encode or decode information out. But if it is completely lost, right, beyond certain point, it is completely lost, and then you'll have trouble. Right. So this study, right, is called typically signal integrity, done by most hardware offices around the world, right, whether it is Intel, Cisco, Nvidia, or memory. all of them have to do this to ship their boats. How do they do this? Well, what they do is they first extract the electromagnetic properties of this bus, right? What is the electromagnetic properties of the bus? How do you represent that? Well, there is something you may have heard called S parameters, right? S parameters are transfer characteristics that you give it this to a tool, or you measure the S parameters of this, then you take the transistor model of the chip side, the transistor model of the load side, right? And you simulate and you can get the bit pattern that you're expecting, right? So that's a typical signal integrity problem that we have seen and continue to see in packages and boards today. The other problem, which used to be dealt with kind of decoupled from signal integrity, right? It's called power integrity. Now, no longer the same. Typically, you have to do signal and power together. What is power integrity? Well, the transistors that are, that are doing the logic for us, they need to be fed with power, right? And power meaning they have to be fed with, if it's a 1.2 volts, there are some constraints and all, right? So there's some limits to which you can allow going down below, but not below that, right? What's going to happen is that when your power shrinks, right, the transistor biasing conditions and all that will be different. Again, let's say there's no signal integrity problem, right? Let's say signals are going very well, but if the power has an issue, then the signals will suffer. Like instead of a 1, you'll get a 0, right? So, and these two problems are quite related. The power and the signal integrity, very related, right? A topic for some time, right? And then we also have EMI, EMC challenges, right? So this is typically typically when you talk about electrical properties of the chip package board, these are the terms you hear, right? Signal integrity, power integrity, EMI, EMC, right? EMI, EMC, this is actually a package from Toshiba with a bare board, right? And just showing you the magnetic field radiation from that, right? So you hold the phone there. They have to meet certain criteria, right? It has to be safe, so it has to be low power. So there is some specifications that these devices that we make or you will make in future in an industry, they have to go through some form of specs, right? They have to meet certain standards. EMI-EMC is something of that kind of a standard. That is for, let's say, if you're talking about phones, people are using it, so there is, you have to have low power just from the specific absorption rate of microwave is concerned, right? But even otherwise, sometimes signal integrity problems can also be considered as EMI-EMC problems, which is, let's say you have an antenna on one part of the package and, distribution, lines, etc. Antenna is supposed to radiate, right? It is its properties to radiate. But if that radiation affects your internal circuitry, right, then that's a problem, right? So that's typically, a little bit about EMI-EMC. So this is where we start talking about automotive electronics and where the opportunities lie today for these kind of problems in automotives, right? So today what's happening is something called, and not today, I think it started like 5 years back, right? You've heard about IoT. To me, the car is the pinnacle of IoT today. What do I mean by that? Car is a place where the IoT syndromes are being seen a lot, right? Perhaps not on my Maruti Istar, but higher-end cars, there's a lot of electronics that are being embedded into the car, right? And then what was happening is this chip is going and sitting into the board, right? This is a normal problem that we have solved so far, but now this board is going and sitting inside an automotive, right? And actually, I have visited Bosch a couple of times, and also Delphi, also Hyundai Mobis, right? These are the automotive suppliers. I've seen all of them have a cut car in their office, right? So right as you enter, you see a cut car, right? Cut car means they've cut it straight at the middle, and what you can see on the periphery of the car is just loaded with electronics, right? You can imagine why. You can see driver assistance systems and all these coming in today. How are they working, right? It's all hidden, right? When you enter a car, you don't see all that, right? At max, you'll see a big box, CPU, etc., in a in a self-driving car, but all of this is hidden behind the view, right? And this is something that, you know, kind of excited me quite a bit a couple of years back when I saw that this car looks like a PCB. It's just a three-dimensional PCB nowadays, right? And, you know, automotives, is industry is 100 years old, right? Previously, it was more like, you know, more of the bill of materials. You know what bill of materials are? Bill of materials is basically what you need to purchase to make that stuff, right? So the bill of material of a car will be the cost of the wheels, cost of the steel, cost of antennas, cost of the electronics, right? So bill of materials in a car was typically mostly mechanical, right? And some thermal parts, etc., mostly mechanical, right? You have an ICE. ICE is the internal combustion engine that is actually powering the car, right? And then most of it is mechanical design and stuff. That situation is changing, right? Just like, you know, probably around 2005, the phone became a very, you know, hot electronic commercial or rather consumer electronic product. The car today, you know, 50% of the bill of materials is electronic or electric. So I don't know whether to call it a mechanical, you know, good or an electronic or an electrical good, right? So that is the, you know, the origin of the thoughts for today's presentation, right? That the car is a system of systems, and there are a lot of problems that are coming up in the car, right? So, well, first about the trends, why there is so much electronics in the car, right? This, you know, you may have read in the newspapers or on the internet, safety is one of them, right? India is making regulations that every car has to be fitted with airbags airbags very soon. And in US, Europe, you will find this is everywhere, right? So, driver assistance systems, right? So, in addition to, you know, my reflexes, I also trust the the sensor that's on the car, right? It can be antennas, it can be cameras, etc., that will stop me from banging into something else, right? So that's life-saving, right? So whenever something is life-saving, the value of it automatically goes up. Connected, right? People say, experts say that tomorrow, just like you call a Uber or an Ola today with your phone, right? Tomorrow you will be able to call a car, but while calling the car, you will be able to specify what you need at that point of time. So experts believe, some people believe, that car won't be an object that you own in the future, right? It's going to be like, you know, you just call a car, it comes, it does your job, goes back, parks itself, and it's gone, right? So imagine today I'm perhaps in the mood to work, so I get an internet in the car. Tomorrow I can get a video screen if I want to watch a movie, so that, you know, this concept of, you know, automatically having this electronics and electrical components already embedded, that comes in, right? So connected is one of the nature, right? So this comes to V2V, is vehicle to vehicle, vehicle to infrastructure, all these kind of communication. Some of it is already working in parts of Europe, right? There's a highway where there's, you know, antennas based on the sides and in the car that actually works there, right? The other one, and you must have heard about this unless you've been in a cave, which is, electric vehicles and the push for electric vehicles, right? And the reason for that is obvious, environmental, right? And also perhaps, so what happens to electrical vehicles is that, you know, people who own a car, right? You know, I have a hard time every 3 months or 6 months doing maintenance, right? Because oil change and all that stuff. So when electric vehicles are really predominant, right now 1% of all cars are electric vehicles, right? It's going to climb up very soon. I'm going to show you that slide as well. But there's no maintenance required for that, right? You just, what is the maintenance that's required on your cell phone? Nothing, because there are no, apart from the wheels and that, there's no moving parts. This is a battery that's feeding into an inverter. That inverter is feeding into your induction motor, and that's driving the vehicle, right? So it's really maintenance free. Big problem with electric vehicles is the cost of the battery. So it is assumed, I mean, it is typical that, you know, half of the vehicle cost could actually be the cost of the battery. So you must have heard of Tesla trying to do mass production of batteries and so on and so forth, right? So these are the trends that are bringing in electronics and electrical components into the car by the drove, right? And therefore, problems, right? So these are some of the challenges, or some of the newspaper items that I have seen from this, right? You may have seen the story of the Tesla problem, Tesla crash with automotive driving because of lack of sensor fusion, right? So there are problems, there are ways that people are figuring it out, how to solve them. Typically what they do is to take the structure that they are putting in the car in a lab and try to simulate it and put some conditions onto it, right? That makes the design pessimistic, that makes the cost of the vehicle high, so that it cannot penetrate the masses, right? So the idea is to, like any other technology, is to bring the cost down very quickly, right, of these things. So just like every challenge is actually an opportunity, you know, hidden behind it. So suppliers like, or the automotive electronic suppliers like Bosch, Conti, etc., they view this as a very big market. It's a very big opportunities for us engineers as well, young guys like you, to contribute in here, because this is quite fun as well, right? It's directly going into something that you can see. So these are some of the electronics and electrical components in the car. So if you know, this is looking at it from the top view, you know, you can see these, I guess this picture is taken from here. These squares, they represent an ECU. What is an ECU? ECU is an electronic control unit, right? Not an engine control unit, but an electronic control unit. And there are, for example, a BMW will have something like a 50 to 100 ECUs. And what is inside an ECU? An ECU may contain one or more boards with, of course, multiple chips in it, right? And what are these lines, these pink lines and all this? These are basically the harness. How are they don't do Wi-Fi, right? They don't do light. How are they going to communicate to each other? It's happening right here through copper. And that's CAN flexing by different colors, is because they are using different standards called CAN flexing, which I'm going to talk about in just a little bit. You may have heard about these, the ADAS radar that sits on the top. I was talking to Chetan, in fact, the other day from TI, and he was saying that, you know, I can easily build a radar chip, a radar PCB, that will work very well in lab conditions. But when I put it in the Bosch lens, right? So many people have to come together, right? So there are chip providers like Cypress, like Texas Instruments, that sell their chips to the component makers, which happens to be Bosch or Continental, etc. They supply to BMW, right? So BMW, Tesla is different. Tesla actually makes their own components, but the others typically rely on the electronic components to the automotive suppliers, right? And the automotive suppliers sometimes, most of the time, rely on TI, Cypress, Intel, NVIDIA for their chips, right? So it has to work together, right? It's just not, you can't take a PCB, radar PCB, and put it right on the front of the car. It'll look ugly. It won't work. So you have to put it on inside a lens, and it's hidden on inside this chamber. But the problem is the antenna behavior changes when you put something, even plastic around it, and this is metal, right? So there are some concerns about that, some interesting research topics. Ethernet, that's the latest technology that's getting into the car. I'll talk about it a little bit more, right? And then, of course, the electric batteries, right? Typically, if you look at most of the common designs of, I think 5-6 years back, there was one battery somewhere. Now, underneath the car is the entire battery, right? Now, lithium ion, right? But that may change, right? And then this battery is giving out DC power into an inverter that's converting it to AC and feeding into an induction motor. Why don't we use a DC motor in the car? I don't know. That's how it started. Tesla started doing induction motor, and that's, I've tried to look up, but there are some positives, negatives, but what it is, most of the electric vehicles today are using induction motor, not DC motor, right? So that's the other trend. So, I talked about signal integrity, I talked about power integrity, and I talked about EMI EMC. And what I want to do is now is to relate this problem in the new system, which is the car, right? What is the signal integrity problem in the car, right? So what we have talked about is in the PCB, there are some traces that are causing problems in carrying signals, right? Now imagine in a car, this is what you don't see when you go inside a car, but this is called the harness system, right? These are basically copper, shielded or unshielded, that happens to lie inside the car on the outside of the body, that carries signals from one ECU to another, right? as it is, there's no Wi-Fi. I mean, there's no wireless connectivity. This is more right now working better in terms of reliability, right? So this automotive harness is the third largest cost of the car after the engine and the chassis, right? And the weight of this harness, if you took the harness out and weighed it, it would be around 35 kgs, right? So that adds to the weight of the car, cost of the car, right? And so in terms of automotive, you've heard about PCI or you may look up on the net about all the different terminologies or technologies we use on the PCB. Similar thing, if you follow in the automotive section, 1983, Bosch invented CAN, which is Controller Area Network. And that's been very reliable, very cheap, but the speed is very small, right? So if you're thinking about taking your camera signals or the video signals in a car, uploading them directly to the cloud, not going to work, right? So 1994 LVDS, this differential signaling, right? I think most common ones are CAN and FlexRay. You can see the speed difference is 10x speed difference between CAN and FlexRay, right? But this is more expensive, so you know people couldn't do that. I mean, it's hard to do this. MOST is used, it's very high speed, but very expensive. It's used for, it's a circular network where the devices are connected, typically used for video in the car, right? But what most people believe is that all of this is going to be completely replaced by single technology, which is internet, right? This is multiple technologies for different parts of the car, so there are some problems with that, right? And so drive towards one standard, single standard, internet standard, right? And talked about this third highest cost in weight in the car, right? And recently an experiment was done by Broadcom and Bosch that demonstrated 80% cost reduction, 30% weight reduction using unshielded twisted pair Ethernet at 100 Mbps. Okay? A lot of things have to work very well for the Ethernet to come completely into the car, but there are challenges and therefore opportunities for all of us to contribute. Why was Ethernet not used in the car before? Well, there was too much noise, right? So Ethernet is high, you know, high speed, and you can imagine what is 100 Mbps in a car is because, you know, you may be familiar with this, but we always measure not by just frequency of operation, but by the electrical size of the structure, right? So a PCB is this small, frequencies of around 3 gigahertz, the PCB can still be one wavelength long, right? But if you now take the same signal in a car, it's like 100 wavelengths, right? So you drop the frequency by one notch, one decade, the car is still 1 lambda, 2 lambda, right? So what's happening is, you know, the difference between transmission line and antennas, antenna was desired to radiate. Transmission lines was desired to take the signal from one place to another without radiating. When a transmission line acts as an antenna, that becomes a problem, right? So these things can start radiating and causing problems to your other ECUs, right? So that's the major challenge in the internet. So yeah, so some of the trends towards signaling in automotive is there's Broadcom has this broad outreach program. You know, so this is an interesting thought, right? This has not reached IEEE standards yet, right? When do we actually make standards? When the research is done, there's nothing else to discover. People have found out what's the right way to do it. So we do standards. So a good time to get into something is before the standards have been made, right? And these standards have not been made yet. But Broadcom has some stuff, you know, going on, right, with Bosch. So there are three technologies that are actually making Ethernet possible, right? So AutoSAR is one of them, which is a single software stack for the entire car. You can imagine if you're going to share your signal to turn off the brakes and the signal to turn on your kid's video on the same bus, right? There are some issues with that, right? So so the heterogeneous architecture that we have now to a single standard, that is what's happening. One of the predictions is automotive Ethernet ports by 2020 will be 400 million, right? And it's predicted by 2030, number of automotive Ethernet ports will exceed any other variety of Ethernet ports. Moving to power delivery, right? This is easier to understand, right? So ICE is a short form for internal combustion engine, right? Most of our cars today, we go to the petrol pump and fill petrol and run. Right? That's called an internal combustion engine. The way energy is being converted is from, you know, from petrol, and we get the energy, right? This is being converted, and IC is being replaced by an induction motor inside the car, right? So the architecture is, there's a battery, right? And this is for pure electric. There's a battery, and the battery is, as I mentioned, inverter to the induction motor is driving. Most cars today have one induction motor driving all four wheels. In future, it's going to be four, I mean, not going to be, but some people believe, and BMW already has an implementation where there are four motors, right? So on each of these, on these cars, right? So that's because of efficiency, right? So this is the prediction by Bloomberg, and you've heard most countries have, are going in this direction to all electric vehicles. So this is a big opportunity, right? So what is an opportunity, right? Opportunity is where you don't have to fight tooth and nail to get a share of the market, right? You know, something is growing, you grow with it, right? So that's an opportunity. Otherwise, you have to take somebody else's market share. Much easier to create your own. So this is, so this is a prediction, 35% of the cars by 2040. Right now, it's 1%. 1% of the cars on the market are electric vehicles. It's going to be 35% very soon. This is the architecture. I talked about this. So this is actually a power integrity problem on steroids, right? So you have a power integrity problem on the board that's 3 volts or 1.2 volts. This is a battery that's 300 volts. Driving 300 volts, this is supplying DC to the inverter. The inverter is converting it to an AC. Induction motor is driving it. This is the chassis, which is the body of the car, treated as the ground. And the inverter is also doing a DC-DC conversion to generate 12 volts. That is feeding your electronics of the car. This is driving the car. This is feeding the electronics in the car. And sometimes noise from here can enter here, and your electronics will have problems working. Right? So this is typically the power integrity problem. Very similar ways of analyzing the problem and solving the problem. And the last part of MIMC, right? So this is, if you talk to automotive guys, this is their biggest challenge. Why is this their biggest challenge? Well, the way Tesla, and one of the questions that can come to your mind is that, why am I talking of this as an opportunity if there are electric vehicles on the road driving, smoothly, right? There are some problems with self-driving, but more software related than hardware related, right? The way it is working today is that, let's say this is my ECU, right? ECU has a PCB in it. So you want to put this ECU inside a car, right? This ECU works very well inside this room where there is no external radiation. In the car, there will be extra, all the radiation will be there from the harness, from the other ECUs, from the radar, etc. So the way people deal with this today is they would take this ECU to a lab and connect it and artificially inject noise into it, just like you would in a car, right? And then they want to make sure that they are below some standards or below some specs. And for automotives, the specs are, every consumer electronic good has to go through this. Not in India, but if you want to sell in Europe and US, there's C standards and FCC standards. You have FCC and C standards, you have to meet them, right? So for consumer electronic goods, the standards or the specs are much less stringent than for automotive electronics. For automotive electronics, you have to basically, they go down, if the level of pass is here for consumer electronics, the level of pass is here for automotive electronics, right? So that's why the cars are still driving on the road, but that's why, people are having a lot of trouble meeting these standards. Let's say the supplier, Cypress, TI, Bosch, Conti, they're having trouble meeting the standards that BMW has given them. Right? That's the MIMC problem. And you will probably see more of these problems in the future with IoT, 5G becoming standards, right? These are high frequencies, they radiate a lot of antennas together in a small area. So these are problems of the future. Now, I think this is my last slide before I hand it over to Vibhu. So this is from an EDA perspective. EDA is Electronic Design Automation. Total market size around 4 to 5 billion in worldwide, right? Synopsys, Cadence, Mentor are the leaders in that. So, you know, if you look at the silicon side, right? So people in Intel, how they bring chips out, right? Or for example, let's, Intel is a large company, let's talk about a startup. Or you, if you want to, let's say, make, you know, you have a great idea that, you know, I want to make this device that is going to do these things, and I'm going to then start my company based on that, right? What will you do first? You have an idea. You have an idea of a device. Perhaps you have an implementation in Raspberry Pi. That's what they're good for, right? Checking out if your idea is going to work or not. So the process that goes here is that you have, you explain the behavior that is desired from your device in the form of behavioral logic, which is also known as RTL, right? And then there are tools. You don't have to do anything. There are tools in the market that will take that behavioral logic and will give you a gate level diagram to achieve that logic. These are called synthesis tools. I think Synopsys Design Compiler is the pioneer and probably still the best tool doing that. So at that point, from RTL, you've gone to netlist schematic. You had an idea. You had a behavioral description. From there, you have now a gate level picture, somewhat more concrete. Then there are tools called place and route that would take that design, right, that gate level design, and then can give you the GDS2 file. GDS2 is something that can be manufactured by fabs, right? So the transistor layout and all that, that will finally do your behavior at the end, right? That's the design tools. And then verification tools, well, you don't know whether your design is going to, GDS2 is just transistors, right? Transistors on the layers, right? What about if you make some wrong connections between transistors and stuff? Wrong means long connections, right? They'll have some problems as well, parasitic problems. So you have physical verification tools like prime time and caliber that check for mainly three things, right? Timing, power, and signal. We talked about most of it, right? What is a problem? You want to detect a 1 that is a 1 and a 0 that is a 0, right? What problems can appear? Well, on the vertical side, because of loss, your signals can become smaller, right? I mean, just amplitude by smaller. That's called noise. Or your signals on the horizontal side may not reach you at the time when you're sampling. That's called delay, right? That's timing, that's power, right? So typically signal and noise, that's timing and signal, right? Power is, of course, another different problem. So there are tools in the market that are actually going to help solve your problems, right? Help you get there. In terms of making your device, assuming that you are not from this area, even if you are in the area, Intel uses a lot of these things, they are in the area, right? So this is a fairly mature EDA framework, a lot of tools available, right? But if you look at a little bit higher level, right, on the PCB side, PCBs have been there for a while, right? But if you look at that, so what happens on a PCB? You take the direct analog of silicon to PCB, PCB does not have, at least today, does not have any transistors that can synthesize something. Like, you know, you give a 1 and you want a 0. PCB cannot do that, right? So there's no synthesis part of it, right? So PCB's job is to do mechanical, electronic, and thermal support for the package, as for the chip, right? So there's no synthesis, but there's place and route, right? How are you going to put the, you know, put the wires connecting different components and all together? So there are some tools. So it's a little more complicated than I wish to go in today, right? But there are tools somewhat there that actually will, place and route is actually quite okay. There are tools in the market that will actually, you know, given what connection, you know, I want to connect point A to point B, point A of the board to point B of the board, they'll give you some connections. You may have to correct it a little bit, but then, you know, it'll happen. And in terms of physical verification, in your discussion with Arun for a long time here, right, there is right now no tool in the market that can take your entire PCB and say, yes, these nets are a problem, these nets meaning traces are a problem, these traces are not a problem. Nothing like it, right? There are some small parts, segments to it, but not the closest, I would say, links, right? Now we scale one more level into something called a system of systems, right? Where, let's talk about, this is more kind of philosophical right now, at least the synthesis part of it. Let's say you take that cell phone out and you call a car and you want to say, I want internet, I want, a video screen, a 4K display. That's all I want. So the car would have to synthesize what kind of ECUs are required to give you the things that you're looking for, right? And then comes place and out. Okay, you have a bit of materials, which means you know what ECUs to use. You also have some copper to connect them, right? But then how do you place and route them so that they're going to work together? Whether do I place the car tire pressure sensor here or there on the tire, right? So that's the place and route. There are some groups, not too many. Physical verification. Most people today would just take it to the lab, as I mentioned, do some EMIMC tests and say this is going to work or not, right? Tools not yet there for doing this on the PC. There are small, you know, bits and pieces of it, but no concrete something. As you can imagine, then, you know, somebody looks at this picture and told, ask me, you know, this industry is just 50 years old, right? And this industry, you know, that's 120 years old. How are you saying that this is a well-made system and this is not a well-made system, right? Perhaps people don't need it, right? Well, I differ, right? This is a system that was mechanical in nature. Nobody, when you talk about a car design tool 10 years back, it was a mechanical engineering design. But when the bill of materials, like, why? What is a tool for? Tool is for, you know, you have a bill of materials and you want to put them together, that's what the tool is for, right? And if your bill of materials are mainly mechanical, you would need a mechanical design tool. Now, when more electronics and electrical components are there, the design tool should be more electrical, right? So this is a recent phenomenon. We will see how it pans out. And you can imagine the future generations. When I talk of automotives, I also talk about the next generation Jetsons, right? Which is drones, your carriers of tomorrow, including space cars, right? All this have the same problem or the same opportunities involved in it. Lot of electronics, right? Of course, there's mechanical parts to it. Of course, there is aerospace involved, but there will be a lot of electronics that would need proper system level performance to be able to actually solve that problem, right? And maybe I'll hand over to Bibu, and I'll come back and talk about a couple of other things.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll start my talk thanking Mr. Espinosa. The last 10 years I'm working in the EMIMC domain. For last 10 years I'm working in EMIMC domain for the Bosch various products like motor, sensor, or ECU. So I'll start with a simple story or simple problem what we faced, I think, 2-3 years before. If there is a diesel gasoline system, there is a sensor which monitors the depth of the diesel or the fuel inside the cell. So what they did is there is the sensor is basically is a metallic rod which is connected to another sensor which says the depth based on some principle. They changed the screw, one of the screw of the metallic rod, from plastic to metal, and the customer reported saying that it is failing with some frequency, some trigger is happening. So this is a customer reported bug, and they come back to us, and we have to see what are the changes that happened that causes this fault, because earlier it was working. So they went into lab and they did some RI test. The RI is radiation immunity test. Basically what did they take the duty, they impede some kind of electric field with some polarization, and they observe the failure. And surprisingly, it started failing again. So the solution, what we did with the help of simulation, instead of we took that full CAD model and we simulate again. The finally, we took the old model where the screw was plastic and we could not repeat the mistake. And suddenly, we called the engineer again. He told that what the changes he made. He told for mechanical vibration standard, he changed the screw from plastic to the metal. And when he put the metal screw back, we saw that again some sharp resonance is coming at that frequency. So what was happening, the electrode has a certain length, and this metallic screw is adding to that length. And because of that, it's resonating some 1.4 GHz around, the resonance was coming. So if you see the EMIMC solution, after you find the solution, it looks very easy. But to find out the solution, the simulation effort, the heat and trial method, both in measurement you have to do, in the simulation you have to do, analysis do, it is much time consuming. The solution, what you do is the putting a 5 nanohenry inductance after the electrode. That 5 nanohenry it was producing enough impedance to obstacle the damp the resonance. That was the solution based on that. So if you see the analysis, this analysis is done in the engineering stage where some guys are there, they check the layout, check the hardware, everything. The testing phase where you take the prototype into the lab and do the various tests to find out the problem. And the simulation engineer where you reproduce the same problem in the simulation software to analyze, to study the field coupling, all other things, other different variants, all these things can be done in the simulation. So if you see the current available simulation tool, or the what are the tools available to do the EMAMS side, is basically this kind of HFSS, CST, FICO, or in the low frequency side you use Sabre or some circuit simulation tool. So all these tools are generic tools. They are not meant for the EMAMS simulation. It can be done for any antenna simulation, to RF design simulation, to EMAMS simulation. Other thing, the other not drawback, and what are the it can be drawback for the EMAMS stand point of view. They're time consuming. If I see an ECU simulation, it takes from 6 hours to 2 days also, depending on the complexity of the ECU. And if after 2 days, you can get the first result to see whether your simulation is giving the reproducing the measurement result or not. If not, then you have to see what are the parameter you are missing to put into the simulation environment to get the actual result. And the simulation result is usually depending on the input to the simulation. You cannot assume that I will not give something and the simulation gives the exact result as measurement. Second thing is that it doesn't have any diagnosis capability. Once you simulate, you get the result. But from where the problem is, that depends on the person who is simulating or the experience of the person to find out where the bug is coming. Third thing, suppose like in this case, I change the one plastic screw to metallic screw, then simulation again will take the same amount of 10 hours or 12 hours to complete it. So there is no design where, the machine learning or the quick re-simulating the 3D environment. In the circuit environment, it is there. And the final is the no full system simulation. So far, even I did all of my simulation in the component level, either in the ECU, sensor, everything. I have not done any simulation with a complete car where all the harness is present, we put so 3-4 ECUs and do a simulation the complete car level. So far, there is no existing tool I can say which does the full car level simulation. Yeah, so talking about standards, EMIMC standards, so each component submodule level has to pass the various standards to fit into the car. So there is a standard like BCI, BCI is bulk current injection, RERI is the basically the radiation immunity and the radiation emission test, TEMCell and DPA, all these are in the submodule, the IC level, they are from the TEMCell or DPA, direct power injection method, even the CE also and the EC also, as well as the IC level they do. So the picture first, picture on the
green
by yeah, this is the vehicle level test. This is reverberation chamber test. This is not 8 into component level, but in the vehicle level, they already started doing that. They put the whole car inside the EMC anechoic chamber. And they rotate the car in various orientation to see where the emission is coming from. And this is the most, in the future, all the companies have to do all this reverberation chamber test. And this is the RE or RI test. You can see a DUT cable and the antenna is there whether to monitor the water, the radiation coming from the DUT, or it is to impinge the field from the antenna back into the DUT under test. So if you see the system, this test comprises of the cable harness running. The cable harness length is around 2 meters. There is a LISN and the load box. Load box is typically, it emulates what are the termination condition for this duty. And this is the duty is there. And the chamber, the distance between the cable and antenna is nearly 1 meter. So if you see the whole system, if there is the commercial tool or the existing tool, it needs a lot of effort to model everything and simulator. So the test method, I'll talk briefly about BCI test, which is a bulk current injection test. This is the RE setup, what I showed is the antenna is there, and the DUT is there, then the anechoic chamber. So any duty which fits into the power has to pass this standard. I mean, there are standard like 6 per 16, like you see the there will be frequency versus radiation profile. With low frequency, some like field strength will be like 40 volt per meter. So it has, any radiation has to be below that. And the frequency, the lines, the limitation will change this frequency. So all the product has to meet the standard to fit into the car. And this is the bulk current injection. Bulk current injection, all the semiconductor company has to pass through this bulk current injection measure test if the chip has to be used in the car. The main motivation is this test is that if you see the car length is over nearly 2 meters, if you say, and the cable harness will be running from one end of the car to other end of the car. And there is a ECU, and other end of the cable, suppose you have some sensor is there. And it sends some signal, give a trigger to the ECU to function, do something like rain sensing sensor is there. If the rain comes, only the wiper will start. What happens is that in certain condition, you would start your mobile, you start the car, it will produce certain amount of noise inside the car. And the cables are there to pick up the noise, and this will get conducted back into the ECU, and it will give rise to false trigger. This test is that you put the DUT under same environment, like DUT is there, there is a 2 meter of cable, this is a termination, and some button point of the cable will inject a high amount of RF noise. And this noise will get conducted through the cable to the DUT, and DUT should be able to sustain this amount of noise, and it doesn't give right to any false trigger. The test method, like there for 50 milliamps, means you give a 50 milliamps of current, and this cable, or in the ECU star, or the automotive standard, the standard is 300 milliamps. So all the active components or the ECU has to sustain this much of a common mode current so that it doesn't give a false trigger. Again, the common mode current means you are giving the same amount of current to the all the harness. Before going into this, so if you see the current tool, as I told, the problem exists, the high timing consuming, there is no learning part from one simulation to other simulation, or there is no sensitivity. Like you simulate some PCB or some ECU, it says that these are the, at this frequency, these are the regions or these are the traces which are highly sensitivity. If you're going to change some component or some traces, it is going to impact me in this band of the frequency. So these are what points we are currently working on or in the lab or what the research area is like. First one, I'll talk about sensitivity. So, 3D simulation, all about the max allocation you solve either in FEM or FTDD or MOM. Then another method of some solving that Maxwell problem is using PIC method, where you represent all the Maxwell in terms of RLDC parameter and do a sensitivity analysis on that. So, if you see the max allocation of the if you break down into the first term is the resistance term, second term is the inductance, third is the capacitance term. So whole the physics of the max allocation can be derived in terms of circuit form. This is the unit, the basic cell of a peak. So if we go, we break down to RLDC form, it is very pretty much easy to do analysis like sensitivity analysis or time domain analysis. All this is much easier in the circuit form rather than in the FEM or FDD form. The 2.5D method that I worked on in our lab is the 2.5D method. The 2.5D PIC method, earlier it was based on only square grid or rectangular grid. Now what we did, instead of square grid, we make the non-orthogonal grid. So PIC method, 2.5D, why it says like, if you see the PCB, the thickness between the planes is very, very small in compared to the frequency. The field variation will be almost like vertical. There will be no sideways coupling in case of, when the separation is much smaller. So that's why the name comes 2.5D. And earlier version was MFDA in the court, where the discretization was rectangular or square grid. So instead of that, we thought we'll come up with some non-rectangular grid so that you can mesh your PCB, because PCB is irregular in shape. If you make the rectangular MFDM kind of thing, it will take huge number of cells. So instead of that, we come up with 2.5D method where you take the non-rectangular cell, and each cell will be like RLDC term, you can say. This is the representation of each peak cell in a SPICE form, just not the simple RLDC circuits. And we validated our method using commercial tool. CST validation, the PDN, the power impedance profile, this is S2 only. There's all this validation where we have coplanar planes. So we take the coplanar coupling into account and we validate it through commercial tool also. And the speed what we got, if you, we simulated the commercial 2.5D peak and not an hour method, we can see we clearly get a speed advantage over the non-commercial tool. And I'll come to the sensitivity part. Like what we did is we divide the grid mesh power structure into different each non-orthogonal cell, and we find the sensitivity of the each cell with respect to certain parameters. Suppose I say the I find the current or the impedance profile. I will see, once I know the each cell differentiation or the variation with respect to that parameter, I can easily find out which cells are more sensitivity to that parameter. So these are the, all the formulation behind the gradient west spy simulation. I'll just keep this. Yeah, so finally you can see the sensitivity plot, but the red one says that this is the PDN. You can see that these are the points where my impedance is highly sensitive, and these are the yellow one, the green one and less sensitive. So if it makes any changes over here, it is going to impact your PDN. Same thing is applied to the decap placement, where each grid we assume one certain decap with respect to brand, ground, and to make the optimization where which are the where the decaps needed, where decap is not needed, you can find out using the sensitivity analysis or the optimization. Second part of the research is like what is a learning based simulation, where you do one simulation and next simulation take some hint or some information from the previous simulation and reuse it, make the faster simulation. This two-day solver, like if you have a design, you change small parameter, again it will take 30 minutes. So instead of that, whatever, I mean, any small or minor detail change will take 3D simulation, again same amount of simulation time. So I think I'll come in the next slide where we have. Yeah, again the antenna placement, you see the car body remains same, but if you change the antenna position, it will take the same amount of simulation. So what with the machine learning and the Krylov recycling does is that you first you solve a problem. Solution is basically you are finding from the eigenspace of the Krylov subspace. Krylov subspace is like if I'm standing in XY coordinate system, any point in that XY coordinate system will be unit vector of X and unit vector of Y. Similarly, Krylov subspace is the vector space where my solution lies. You can take n number of vector out of that and make a vectorial addition, you'll find a linear solution. So what we did that, you have a solution in the one frequency, or next iteration, you take the Krylov subspace from the previous one. We use as a starting point, then you will get the number of iteration or number of count will come down drastically to reach at your solution. Third one is the in the mesh interpolation. Like for Krylov subspace, if you change something, your mesh is going to change. Because mesh is going to change, you have to find the solution of the old system at that mesh point. So what we do instead of re-simulating, we do an interpolation on the previous mesh for the new mesh and find the field value, whatever the current value on those points. Just the mesh interpolation is the old mesh and the right hand side is the new mesh and we found the. And this is the method where you use the previous eigenvalue or the eigen Krylov subspace to find the new solution space, because this is where the old solution lies. We find the Krylov surface, we find the initial vector for this new simulation and populate that into the initial guess and do the iteration. It will come down and it converts very much easier or more less iteration. And based on that, we have some examples. We see that this is where if you don't have the initial guess, it will converge into some 420 iteration. If you use the reuse the Krylov subspace, it will convert in some 180 iteration. That's because you have already know the where the solution subspace lies. In different example, we tried that method. You can see the cost saving of the method. So this will hand up.
So quickly finishing up. The other parts that we are working on. So some people ask me how fast, we are trying to make this simulation very, very fast, right? How fast is very fast, right? So my answer there is that today it takes probably, you know, to simulate, let's say, an Intel board, it might take you 7 days if you have enough memory to actually fit it in proper 3D, right, in proper 3D simulation. So from 7 days, where we want to go is real time, and at least close to seconds, right, so that you can debug easily. Of course, it's not going to be perhaps, you know, second decimal place or third decimal per place accurate, but, you know, if you getting there, right? So we use a lot of the techniques that we talked about, sensitivity, learning-based methods. The other one that I just want to briefly talk about is, and you'll see why we want to do this, right? At the very end, you'll see why we want to do this. Parallelization, right? So parallelization, you know, the way I say this a lot, right? So I'll say it again, right? If you're not parallelizing your software or your simulation tools, then you're basically missing out on a lot of stuff, right? So for example, if you had written a software code in 1980s, right, in the year 2000, it was running 100 times faster without you doing anything, because of Moore's law, the processor speed increased, and therefore your software is running fast. But today, if you are writing time-critical software code, right, if you write a software that is not parallel, you know, 10 years from now, it's going to run take the exact same amount of time, because all the transistors that we get out of Moore's law is being put into making more cores rather than increasing the frequency, right? So it's very important. We have tried a few different techniques. This is CPU parallelization, which is typically your laptops have multiple cores, maybe 4, maybe even 8. So you can actually break down the matrix into different parts and can do, this is a work done long time back, 2011, even before that. You can parallelize and make a good speed up on top of that, right? This is interesting. This is something that, you know, this is courtesy my previous company, Nimbic. So there what we did is you could simulate it on the cloud, on the AWS or Amazon cloud, where you can actually send the design, it'll automatically upload, and it'll spawn up different machines to solve that problem. And, you know, let's say if you are one day away from tape out, right, you may want to have 100 machines running your problem. You may not have 100 machines. So you basically just upload that problem onto the cloud, solves it fast, you get the results down, right? Yeah, so this is one of the challenges that we did in a long time back again. You know, big board, we could solve it in reasonable amount of time, right? You can see 7.3 minutes, so getting there. CPU, GPU parallel. We did look at GPU. For our cases, GPU was not that effective because our matrices are like 30 GB, maybe, right? And each GPU has 6 GB, at least the last time I checked. Nowadays, maybe a little bit better. So GPU didn't work that well, but we looked at FPGA. In fact, Anand worked on this with Professor Vargas from VAC department. And we basically made an FPGA chip or FPGA design that could solve our algorithms faster. So that, you know, we had some good success over there, right? This is the speed up that we got there. Very recently, we have taken, this has worked very well for us so far. This is the Intel's Nice Landing architecture. There is one machine in ISC right now that's in Professor Govind Rajan's office. So we got access to that. And this is actually a mesh network of processors. So there are around 72 cores on this machine and 412 GB of memory, RAM 412 GB, right? So, and not very expensive, right? $3,500 or so, right? If you consider the cost of the software, these softwares sell around $20,000 to $30,000, sometimes $50,000. So you can actually throw in a hardware along with the software to make it fast. So this is, which is called a many-core, right? So this difference is a little bit unclear to me, multi-core versus many-core. We'll have a discussion sometime. But many-core is basically mesh networks, you know, by definition, many-cores, right? And memory accessible, right? There's cache that are shared, there's RAM that's shared. So we got quite a bit of speed up. And writing parallel code, it may seem like just a software job, it's not. It's an algorithm job, right? Because if your algorithms have serial content in them, which means you cannot do B before you do A, then you cannot parallelize that, right? That's called Amdahl's law, right? So we have here done only one commercial solver. There are commercial solvers that parallelize well, by the way. But still, there's one commercial solver that didn't do that well, and we could get around 60x speed up on 72 core, right? All of this to make simulation so fast that you can do this 3D immersive diagnosis. The demo is here. If anybody is interested, we'll call one volunteer in a minute. So this is a new way of looking into the PCB, right? So this is Anup, who is actually using his, this is an Oculus Rift glasses. With that, you saw the BCI test, you can actually be inside. And, you know, the movie does it also, I'll just keep going. Here you can see the traces inside the PCB. So perhaps you can get an idea of how this can be useful. You can take a look at this, looks much better on immersive, right? It may be useful for debugging purposes, right? So instead of looking at it on a in a laptop, you can actually look at the fields so that's why we want to do real-time simulation, so that let's say if you change one trace direction a little bit, then you can see how the electric field and all that changes directly into the PCB. So that's the actual size of the PCB. Mm-hmm. And then you can plot current densities on the PCB and look at this, right? So one volunteer from the students. So unfortunately, this is not demoable because he's just wearing the glasses and will see it, right? But you can at least take a look at Tanu. Can you start? Before you start, I'll just tell you the controls, right? So these are the controls. This is not the one that we use. Right? So the only buttons that works are these. Right? If you press both of them, that you haven't started, right? If you press both of them and do this, it will zoom in, and then you use it, and then you want to zoom out like this, right? So like this, zoom in, zoom out. Okay? And then this guy, right? If you press all four buttons, right? Again, only gesture away, just to get rotating 100%. It doesn't matter. You just figure it out. They have time. That's all. Okay. Yeah. I'll put this one on you. Can you share with your friend your experience later on? So now, yeah, if you sure, yeah, PCP or not. Keep that pressed, keep them, these fingers pressed. And then all four fingers, you can rotate it. No, rotate it, also hands out. And yeah, now zoom in. Yeah, rotate a little bit. You can see the PCB around you, right? Yes. Zoom in further. Get inside. And I'll put this on for you. This is the current density. Again, the same controls. Now you can see which stages have more current, which doesn't. Well, he has fun. Any questions? All right, so if you have no questions, then we'll stop here. You can just come and take a look.
How do you plan to integrate this into your product?
Yeah, so, you know, basically the product that we are making at the company is mainly software product for the laptop, right? In general, that's installed on your laptop and runs on the server gives you results, right? What we plan to do is that some of these results are going to be cached for different placements and stuff. Then, you know, you attach this display to the laptop. While you're changing, let's say, position of components, you can actually see the change in the current density on the structure, right? So we will, you know, I think this is somewhat new, so we'll figure out the business model for it. We need your help. Okay, cool. Thank you. We also have, after this, I think, coffee tea outside. We can go ahead. Thank you.
Thanks to Dipanjan and Guru. Thanks a lot. I'm sure it was interesting, right? So, where you can take virtualization to the next level, right? And actually see the benefits for your real-time I have one request, so can you please sign up for this team? So, just make sure that we have another request is in a membership. Some of you guys have ICP membership. And you know, I would appreciate if you can sign up to be an ETS member also. ETS stands for Electronic Packaging Society. We started off this, as I said earlier, 10-12 years ago, with the intention to create awareness. And as Arun said, we conducted a course over weekend, you know, for industry folks in 2005. This community was also part of that. You know, this is a niche area, and you know, we definitely will see. You know, in the marketplace, the requirement are, you know, increasing jobs, right, availability at some point. And, you know, again, the industry should not look elsewhere, right? We should have, it's like two ways. So make sure that, you know, you generate interest within yourself. So this is a good platform that we have created with the request. Okay? So thanks a lot for coming down and spending time with us. Anything you want to add?
Yeah, just one thing. So, you know, a colleague of mine is looking for some expertise. If you're a student, some expertise in Qt, GUI. If you have that expertise, you can just, you know, send me drop me an email or just keep your information here. We'll take it.
Hi, Arun, you want to add anything? I'd like to introduce Anil here. So this is the current setup of the office there for this society, right? So my associate, myself, and Chair, Mr. Murthy, is the vice chair. Anil, he is with IBM. So he's also quite, you know, closely worked with us. He's been working with us for 10 plus years, together with Arun and Dipanjan. So he was, in fact, with Mr. Murthy. So, and then Arta, he was Dipanjan's student, right, at some point, and then he's working. So we are the office bearer and Arka is the secretary, okay? We'd like more you know, contributions and also participation. Thanks a lot. Thank you. So please join me. So as Dipanjan said, we have coffee tea.